Rebel fans don't mind the high-scoring games. They would just like the defense to hold the opponents down a little bit more and keep those high-scoring totals coming on the offensive side here in 2021. Welcome to the Voice of College Football. We're breaking down Ole Miss football. We got Leanne Herring on the line from the Rebel Walk to break down first recruiting. Leanne, we appreciate you stopping by to talk to us.
Well, thanks for having the Rebel Walk on the show today, Mark, and we're excited to, I think we're officially 24 days away from the college football season officially being full swing, and I know everyone's excited to get back in the stands and you know, finally have a full year of college football. I know Ole Miss is.
Yeah, so as we look ahead to the 2022 recruiting class, of course, the dead period ended at the end of May. Teams had to try to play catch-up from that standpoint. Ole Miss has 10 commits right now, 13th in the SEC, number 52 in the country. Not a lot of people would be impressed with that, but that's obviously 6 or 7 months before December and the first signing period. So where does the class stand? Who are some of those targets?
Exactly. Like you said, the 2022 class, I think, continues to be what I like to call a fit in the sip rebuilding class. Definitely not the class that Lane Kiffin put, you know, in his first semi-season with Ole Miss, you know, as far as the rankings and positions to go. But like you said, Mark, there's still plenty of time ahead. And I think that the fall, now that things are opening back up and recruits are going to be able to come on campus and actually experience game day, I think that's really when we're going to see a team like Ole Miss, who's been relatively quiet on the recruiting trail, but doesn't mean they haven't been hard at work, really start to, you know, heat things up. And we're going to see a lot of key battles. As fall camp started, we're in day four. The team was off yesterday, and you know, now they're back in session for the last day. We're going to go into the weekend, kind of seeing where the positioning stands and everything. Two of the top positions, obviously, that the Rebels are going to have to nail in 2022 from what we have, you know, returning and not returning. Obviously, the number one concern is how are we going to replace Matt Corral? You know, we haven't even started the season, and he's done a phenomenal job, and he continues to even develop even more during this fall camp and fall season. But a realistic conversation is that we're going to have to shoot for a 2022 QB. You know, there's been talk of either targeting the transfer portal. There's a few available. And, you know, some of the key ones that they're looking at right now as far as trying to, you know, fill that void in 2022, the top three on the board is Tavian Jackson. He's a hard commit to Tennessee. He's a kid out of Indiana. You know, the number 120 overall QB. He's been a target. He's really athletic, physical. He's a playmaker. Like I said, he gets off the ball really fast, but he's also a hard commit to Tennessee. Two of the other kids are looking, you know, at the QB position for the 2022 class to try to flip is one kid that they're really high up on out of Cali, Justin Martin, 4-star. He seems to have the most segue. He's been on campus, was really impressed by the campus, and the coaches are really impressed by him. 6'4", 210. He's the number overall 20 QB in the 2022 class out of California. Like I said, he camped in and did an unofficial in June, and that's a kid that they really have a good chance with. He's a hard commit to Cal right now, but like I said, he's been really upping the relationship with them. And the final one, he's a bit of a project. He's out of Sikazi, Texas. Alex Orhe, very, very physical player. He's got an intense high IQ on the field with his reads. He would be an excellent, you know, one that we would want to get, like I said, because of his ability as a playmaker, but also his high football IQ. He's a 3-star. Like I said, he's the number 26 QB in his class, a number overall state player in the 28 class, 6'2", 226. But he is also a hard commit to Virginia Tech. So right now, as far as trying to replace Matt Corral, it's going to be a very tough job. But those are the top three on his board. There's another name. You know, I always want to look to the board to anticipate, because when you have your highest position, you know, with your scholarships offering with an offense like Ole Miss, you really, really have to choose and be picky at who you're going to put to be your signal caller, especially with the kind of offense Lane Kiffin runs. And, you know, I was going through the 2022 classes because, like I said, QB is one of those positions that, you know, is very hard to find somebody that's open book. And there's a kid right now. He's out of New Jersey, out of Kansas, New Jersey. Under the radar kind of kid. His name's Devin Kagerman. He did a really impressive job at the QB Elite out in Philly this past spring, 6'3", 220. He's not been offered by Ole Miss, but he's been offered by, you know, LSU, and a few other SEC schools and everything. And he might be someone, you know, that the Rebels might be interested in, you know, as far as, like I said, still very open commitment, you know. And like I said, the Rebels have had really a good luck in rebuilding a lot of their defensive side of the ball and a lot of recruiting a lot of players, you know, on the offensive side of the ball with the New Jersey pipeline. So definitely those are some of the targets we're going to see. But TV is really the first position that's really going to be need to look at in this 2022 recruiting class. Another key position that Lane Kiffin obviously inherited in trying to rebuild this team has been the defense. The defense has really been the Achilles heel even before Kiffin got here to be able to do. And it seems like in the 21 class, they started the foundation to continue. They added a lot of size and depth. And if you know, you mentioned those hard commits that we have from 10, a lot of in-state talent, including, you know, the top JUCO linebacker, Reginald Hughes. But we also need to continue to build depth. So another position they're really looking to target in 2022 is at the linebacker position that they're really going to have to fill in order to continue to add the defense. If you notice on some of the hard commits that we have, you know, Xavier Harris, Jacarius Clayton, two flips that we were able to get as this past summer, you know, during the open season of recruiting and whatnot during June and July. And those were two big additions. We finally have added some size to that defensive line. So you can expect that the Rebels would continue. But, you know, anybody will say that the linebacker position is like the quarterback of the defense. And there's some names up there, of course, you know, on top of the list, Stone Blend, really high up on there. Another, you know, in-state kid from Mississippi, very talented, highly recruited. Family has very strong ties to Mississippi State, but, you know, that could be a very potential flip at the middle linebacker position. Another kid out of Georgia, Jaron Willis, he's also a hard commit to Georgia Tech. That's someone, you know, a potential middle linebacker. So I said they're looking to hopefully build, you know, with Reginald Hughes being already a hard commit, looking for 3 to 4, you know, linebackers. There's another interesting name I want to throw out there that is not on the Ole Miss board at the linebacker position, but he's out of Mater D. Day in California, and Max Crutch just recently came out with the top players, and they made the number one position, and they're known for producing top high school football talent. He's 6'3", 220. His name's David Bailey. He's the number overall 9 linebacker in his class, the number 5 overall player in the state of California. Like I said, that's another name that, you know, may show interest here in the near future. Like I said, as the shift changes on the recruiting trail. But like I said, the linebacker and the QB position as fall camp goes out, you know, we have Luke Altemeyer at the QB position doing really good things with the second team as fall camp has started. But like I said, realistically, Matt Corral's probably going to go into the draft, you know, and go in the first round. So the Rebels really, really have to start looking early on. And, you know, there's been, of course, the Arch Manning talk, but, you know, 2023, as close as it is, it's also a long time to wait for a QB. And, you know, obviously, so the linebacker position and the Rebels want to continue to build upon, you know, especially on the defensive front to continue to build depth. So I like to say that the 2022 class as of now is not necessarily the names that you know, but they're the fit and the sip. They're continuing to be Lane Kiffin's foundational class as far as rebuilding the defense and continuing to make their offense extremely explosive, adding a lot of young talent and whatnot.
Please like the video, share the videos out on social media, because if you enjoy the content, then others will as well. And of course, subscribe here at the Voice of College Football. We got Lee Ann Herring on the line from the Rebel Walk and bringing us the recruiting news from both 2022 and looking ahead to 23 to a certain extent. And in regards to the offense this season, Lane Kiffin had made a comment to a number of times during the summer that Matt Corral was the best quarterback coming back in college football. He certainly looked at that way at times, maybe minus some of the picks. He's already made his way into Ole Miss history a number of times in the record book, but limiting the interceptions would be a good step in the right direction.
Yes, and exactly. And I think Corral is really, you know, a lot of people have kind of, Ole Miss has kind of been shunned out of the preseason polls, you know, when ESPN dropped their top 5 SEC run games and Ole Miss was left out of that. But I think it's kind of right now the players along with the coaches and everything are really using that to work with a chip on their shoulder. And it seems to be working. When you look at what Matt Corral did, despite, you know, those interceptions, he's really improved, you know, just in the first week of fall camp, He even looks even better than he did, you know, after his season that he had last year. Because if you think about it, in 2020 against an all SEC schedule, he became only the fourth SEC quarterback in college football history to lead the nation in total offense per game, you know, and he joins the company of Pat Sullivan, Johnny Manziel, you know, and the third being Rex Grossman. So after, like you said, the yardage he threw and what he did, and he looks to even be proof. But I think what you're really seeing in the offense right now, especially in fall camp, it looks really explosive. And granted, they aren't in a game day out this year. Granted, they don't have Alabama and other teams breathing down. The defense is breathing down their neck. But I think what we're really going to see even not just more explosiveness, but more consistency because of the returners in the starting position we have, not just in Matt Corral, but also it's the entire backfield return to Ole Miss. You have Ely and Connor, which is probably one of the best dynamic duos in the SEC. And then you have Parrish Bullock and, of course, John Rhys Plumlee. Continuing to be changed to the slot is going to be he's going to become really an impact player. And we're already seeing it, you know, just from fall camp and just what little we've seen there. So it's going to be really interesting to see Plumlee and the packages that Kiffin's going to run for Ely as far as the offense, because, you know, during SEC media days, Kiffin mentioned how expect not just for Ely to be, you know, taking handoffs, but also, you know, be taking catches as well. So it's going to be really interesting now to see, you know, Plumlee make that transition to the slot and then having a dynamic duo like Ely and Connor and, like I said, Parrish out there to really, if that offense couldn't be even more explosive, it probably is. But one of the key points, you know, I think for this offense and especially for Matt Corral is that it's consistency. This is the first season that he's not going to have a new offensive coordinator. He's not going to have a new, you know, scheme to learn. There's finally some stability and consistency. And I think that's really helped Matt Corral in this offseason. And like I said, we're already seeing what being able to have, you know, the same kind of pattern going in the routine has really helped him and along to be even a stronger signal caller. Like I said, now having the same offense, same read, same play calling, surrounding by, like I said, all the returning talent and the young talent that's fixing to emerge is going to be really, really a key factor. I think that's going to make even offensively Ole Miss even more explosive. And one of the key things that I think has been really for the Rebel offense this year is, like I said, the returning of veterans. And one particular area is that offensive line. They're returning four of their five offensive linemen, which is huge. So there's not going to be a lot of transition. So Corral's really going to be able to have a protective front force as insurance to be able to focus on getting to those target playmakers that I've spoken about in Ely and Plumlee and Parrish and whatnot. So like I said, you know, the transition and things for Matt Corral and his arsenal have been very smooth in comparison to last year. And like I said, I think again it's that consistency finally that Kiffin has brought the foundation along with the consistency of having Levy as the same coordinator and having a lot of returning veterans in that backfield as long as new talent emerge.
Yeah, 64 starts back along the offensive line despite the loss of right tackle Royce Newman to the Green Bay Packers in the NFL. And like you, Leanne, I cannot think of five better backfields in the SEC. So I don't know what the ranking system was there, but I think the Rebs are certainly a top five unit at running back. And John Rhys Plumlee already showed us with some key catches down the stretch in the Outback Bowl that he could be a factor in the slot. So another weapon there for Ole Miss football, despite losing their two best pass catchers this past season. Leanne Herring joining us from the Rebel Walk to break down Ole Miss football with the season just about 3 weeks away. Leanne, we appreciate you stopping by. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having us, Mark, and hotty toddy.